from the agri sector. So he has been a core mentor personally to me, and also currently is the director of sales and marketing of Indokarma Kokan Fertilizers, Uzbekistan. He has a whopping 39 years of experience in total, and he started his career way back in 1987 and moved on to Tata Chemicals in 1995 and worked in sales, marketing, supply chain, new business development, and corporate affairs as well. Worked very, very closely with projects like Tata Chemicals, Biofuels, KidSafe Vegetables Marketing, customized fertilizers, and Smart Krishi. So pretty much to, you know, put it over to all of you saying that he is somebody who we have been kind of lucky to be, you know, onboarded on. And he is someone with not only vast experience, but I would also say that he is someone who has the varied experience of tasting the success, as well as getting enough and more of learning from the not so called successful works that he has done. So B.B. Singh sir, welcome, and it's great to see you again in this forum. We would welcome you and have you take over from here. So my first question for you is going to be, what are the different challenges that you see in the current times that can come up as an opportunity for agri and allied sector entirely? So, sir, unmute yourself, please. You're on mute. I can see that.
Is it okay now?
Yes. So welcome one more time. And here is the forum for you. We would love to hear from you. What is your opinion? And with your vast experience, what is it that you see as a see-through change in the agri and allied sector with COVID and the challenges that has been around the corner, not only in India, but across the world? So over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Sorry for joining 10 minutes late, because I was trying to connect through my laptop, but there was some problem in the laptop. So finally, I am now connected through my phone. I hope I'm audible to everybody.
Yes, pretty much you're audible.
Okay.
We can hear you very clearly.
Okay, so good evening to all of you. And thank you for this opportunity to talk to you once again. And it's always a pleasure to be connected with you, because I always learn whenever I had some opportunity of this nature. So without getting into much of formalities, I'll straight away get on to the topic. And I'll begin by saying that, you know, the recent announcement made by Government of India, especially the Finance Minister, wherein she talked about, 20 lakh crore package to sort of support the Indian economy. In that package, there are two very striking reforms, which actually are worth discussing. And, whenever these kind of reforms are announced, it is very difficult to find out what is in it for us as an entrepreneur.
Right.
Because it's a announcement which has happened today, but we don't know the details of it. So and the implication of it. Therefore, we keep guessing, and, the opportunity slips away. So, because I have put in almost four decades in agriculture, so I have my own views on it. And so I thought it might be good to share with budding entrepreneurs like you. So that's the background, and I'll begin by saying that agriculture worldwide is supported. It is not possible to do agriculture production without government support. Now, this support worldwide is given by different government in different forms. In India, the support is available in two forms. One is input support, agri-input support, and second is agri-output support. So when we talk about agri-input support, it's basically the subsidies on fertilizers, irrigation, then pesticides, seeds, and farm equipments and implements. So these are the subsidies. Then, of course, crop insurance and other things are also available in the form of subsidies. As far as agri-output is concerned, it is a sort of controlled. It's a support which is available where government promises to hold the market at a level so that farmers don't lose out. So that support is available today. You can also say that input is subsidized and output is controlled. So these are the two supports which are available to a farmer in India. Now, this is the support which is available. Now, in this background, let's look at who the farmer is. The farmer typically in India is the one who owns the farm. Now you can debate, but that's not the topic for the day. The one who owns the farm, we believe that he is cultivating his farm, and he requires three different category of skills. The first category of skill is that which is largely the desk work, which is the pre-production part of it, pre-production of any crop. Then second is production part, and third is the post-production part. So you can divide the crop cultivation in three segments. Now, pre-production requires a planning skill. You know, how do you understand the market? What is in demand? Where do I source the fertilizer? Where do I buy the seeds? Where, which variety should I grow? Which crop should I grow? What is my soil health? So all these desk work is required. Second is the production part, which is production is basically the action in the farm. So that means it's an operation. How do you prepare your field? How do the sowing? How do you apply the fertilizer, pesticide, irrigation, and all that? Till the time you harvest the crop. So all these technologies which he is implementing at the farm. The third is area is post-harvest, which is last post-production. Now, just imagine that a farmer with his limited education, how can we ensure these three different category of his skills in one individual? And it's always challenging even when we study the subject, even when I studied agriculture after doing BSCAG, then I had to choose one subject, which is agronomy, where you study the field crops. Now, so that means you are looking for a specialization. Now, here is a farmer who requires three different types of skill to be successful in farming. So I leave this point for you to introspect and debate how can we improve the competence and skill of the farmer in these three areas so that he can benefit. That's the second point I wanted to make. The third point, which is the subject of the day, where this announcement reform has happened, I would say that it's a reform which is going to have a long-term impact on Indian agriculture in a big way, big way. So you have to see it through and you have to understand it, that how it is going to happen, what we are talking at the moment. So there are two things. One is APMC, which is Agriculture Produce Market Committee Act. Second is the Essential Commodity Act. So Government of India has announced that they will amend the Essential Commodity Act, which is a central law, which is a law enacted by central government. So they will amend the Essential Commodity Act and thereby deregulate the cereals, pulses, oil seeds, edible oil, potatoes, onions, everything, all the agri commodities to be deregulated. So the, what that this deregulation means that there is no stock limits. There are no hoarding laws. So you are free. You are free to hoard, store the material, stock it in season, and then release it in the off season and take the advantage in the market. So that's the amendment which Government of India has announced. Now, APMC is a state law. It is enacted by state government. So there is always a difference between what has been enacted in Odisha and what is enacted in West Bengal and what is there in UP or Bihar. Bihar, in fact, APMC has been scrapped. So there is no APMC Act in Bihar. So we'll talk that separately. So this APMC is a state law. Now, the key point to understand that Government of India says that besides amending the ECA, Essential Commodity Act, they are also going to institute a central law which will exist by the side of APMC. That means APMC is not scrapped or not removed, but a new law from a central government is going to be put in place which enables the farmer to sell his produce outside APMC mandis. Now, this is the business opportunity. That now today the farmer is mandated or it is compulsory for the farmer to go to APMC markets or market yards and sell the produce through the registered commission agents which are called adatiyas. And opportunity is that the lot of the farmer, which is a food grain lot or whatever produce he has taken, will be auctioned in a transparent manner so that he gets the best price of the day. So APMCs have been created basically to prevent exploitation of the farmer. And second is to ensure that he gets a good price at a marketplace where there is enough competition between buyer and the seller, that is the farmer and the buyer. To facilitate the process, commission agents are there in place to ensure that transaction is done in a transparent manner. Now, just at this juncture, let me also tell you that the efficiency of the market is measured by what percentage of bill, what percentage of price farmer is getting from consumers spend. What I'm trying to say is, as a consumer, when I buy, let's say, sugar, so what is the price which sugarcane grower is getting for his sugarcane crop? If I am buying sugar at, let's say, 32 rupees a kg, what price the farmer of sugarcane grower, the farmer, the one who is growing sugarcane, what price he is getting? So the indicator, the normally the study says that in India, 25% to 33% of consumer price is what is available to the farmer. Now, this also, let's not misunderstand this, because this varies from crop to crop. And because if the value addition is very high, obviously the price of the farmer will be, percentage of price of the farmer will be low. But if the value addition in the crop is less, then obviously it will be a little high. But the moment this 25% to 33%, that means the one who is growing the crop, he is getting only 25%. And the consumer is paying 100%. That means 100 rupees he is paying and 25 is what is admissible to the farmer. So 75 is shared in the value chain. Now, it's not that it's an exploitative mechanism, but world over, if you see, this is the phenomena. I have seen world over, even US, Europe, across the geography, you will find that this phenomena is there everywhere. It depends on what kind of value addition is happening, and accordingly, farmer's price is available to him. So this is about APMC ECA. So the point I was trying to make is that the central government is going to add a new law which will exist by the side of APMC. That means APMC markets have to now compete with the private markets. That means, what it means is that as an entrepreneur, suppose in your area there is a potential to grow maize, and you convince the farmer and enter into a contract. Now, contract farming is a new business opportunity which is going to emerge with this. All along, past 15 years, you must have studied about contract farming, but the real opportunity is existing now. Now, this contract farming will become, common and very easy doable, because there is no law, there is no intervention from government to prevent contracts. And you can talk to the farmer and convince them, grow the crop and buy the produce directly from them without any interference from APMC Act or state governments. Even this new law, which gets applicable whenever, it will dismantle the state boundaries. That means you can grow in Orissa and take it to Andhra Pradesh. You can grow in Orissa, take it to UP. Wherever you find better price, you can move the quantity without any barriers. So that means India, for farmer, India becomes one single market. A farmer can go grow in Orissa and take it to Gujarat to sell the produce if he is getting better price. So that kind of freedom, and even similarly, a buyer. Till now, buyers and farmers were restricted to APMC markets. Now you have freedom whether you want to go to APMC or you want to deal outside APMC. Choice is yours. Whichever is getting you better price, please go ahead. So buyer also benefited, and the producer also benefited, because they have freedom to transact outside the APMC markets. Now, there are processors. There are food processors, small scale food processors, who want the continuous supply of these kind of agri-produce for processing purposes. So they will directly get in touch with the farmers and invest in, production of quality food, quality food grains, quality maize, quality potato, and thereby productivity, transfer of technology, everything will happen. And then the, farmers also will benefit, food processor also will benefit, and consumer will get quality processed product. That means the Indian agriculture now will be able to compete with the global markets, compete in the global markets, because you can use the technology to its fullest extent. Today, farmer is hesitant in using the technology, but now with this law in place, it opens out the whole thing, and now you can, use the technology, grow the crop, get the better price, whether it is within the country or outside through exports or imports, whatever. So you can really benefit out of it. So this was the third aspect. So this is the major reform which has happened. And along with the reform, there are two, three things which has been announced. One is that vocal for local. What does it mean? The micro food enterprises, the small scale locally manufacturing industry, processing it, industry, they will be encouraged to get into it, because there is complete freedom now. There is no market cess to be given. There is no market. There is no intervention from the state government. You can directly talk to the farmers. There is a huge business opportunity for investment in warehouses, because now for quality warehouses, for cold chains, every time it was being talked about, but very little has developed. Now there is opportunity because there is a complete freedom. You can have a quality warehouse wherein you can have cooling chambers, you can store potatoes, you can store tomatoes, you can store onions, anything you want. You can store food grain and releases as per the market demand. Similarly, Operation Green, which was applicable for tomato, onion and potato, where the transport subsidy is admissible from the state government to the grower, has been extended to all vegetables. So that's another good announcement which has happened. Now, as you must have realized, that with this kind of a freedom, knowing that the size of land holdings are small, it will be still difficult for a buyer or a food processor to transact with so many farmers. So the FPOs, the farm producer organizations, which we have been talking for very long and trying to put all kind of support, but very little has actually surfaced. There are some success stories of FPOs, but by and large, we can't say that every FPO in India is a successful proposition. Now, with these kind of reforms, contract farming and FPOs will get a huge boost. They will actually become, suddenly they will prop up. And it will be today, all along we have been learning and hearing that these FPOs are, you know, promoted and, you know, by a group of farmer, like-minded farmers for aggregation of land, for aggregation of decision-making and all that. But now these FPOs are more needed by the buyer, by the food processor than the farmer, because it will help the buyer more than the farmer. So in the process, the important is that if FPOs survive, both producer and the buyer both benefit. And since it is going to be supported by the buyer because his interest is there, to in order to minimize the transaction and make it cost effective, then these FPOs will become very, very efficient. Like, I'll cite an example. If you see the cooperative dairies, which are now converting into producer companies because you know, the managing the producer companies easier than the cooperative societies. So if you see the Amul dairy today, all these cooperative societies are producer companies which are supplying milk. They are all control is not the right word. They are actually monitored by, you know, representative of Amul dairy. That means the processor is monitoring the producer companies which are farmed by the producers. So this is the big change. This is the point I was trying to stress upon, that these FPOs are now going to be a reality, and contract farming will become a very prominently successful proposition. Warehousing, there is a huge opportunity. Cold stores, cold chains will become very, very visible across the market area. And one more point I wanted to add before I conclude is that also this is an observation, not a policy point which I am trying to make, that wherever supposing the population of, let's say, Bhuvaneswar district is, let's say, 30 lakhs. Out of this 30 lakhs, maybe 12 lakhs reside in Bhuvaneswar city, 18 lakhs in the rural area. I don't know exact number. I'm just trying to give you an example. Now, if this 12 lakhs means what percentage, it will be about 40%. So 40%. Now this 40%, when it exceeds 50% or 55% or 60%, that means the urban population, when it increases, the demand for agri produce also increases. And all those districts where the urban population is higher than the rural population, you will find that farmers are getting better price. Now, this is an observation which you can validate, agree, disagree, I leave it to you. But this population dynamics has a bearing on what the producer gets, what the price he gets. And so the point is, if you encourage urbanization, of course, Corona is not supportive of what I'm making the statement that today rural is more safe than the urban. But if you encourage urbanization, then probably the farmers will benefit more out of it than otherwise. Last point before I end is that I've been thinking aloud that public distribution system in our country is basically created to support the rural poor, not only rural poor, but poor in general, whether urban or rural, both. Today, there are 23 crores ration cards which have been issued. And about 5 million tons of rice and about 3 million tons of wheat is distributed through this PDS system. In some state, it's 1 rupee a kg, some state 2 rupees kg, some state 3 rupees kg. Different states have different parameters for this. So it is a subsidized ration. Now, I was thinking aloud that, you know, we today in India, we are surplus producer of everything except edible oils. Edible oil is where we are still a net importer, and the rest of the products, whether it is cereals, pulses, potatoes, sugarcane, fruits, vegetable, we are producing at least 30% more than what we require, in spite of the fact that our productivity levels are low. My point is that if the PDS is mandated to distribute processed food only, that means no wheat, no rice, you give them only processed food, and processed food subsidized and distributed through PDS at whatever subsidized price, so you will get a ready-made market. Because here the point is that India at its current productivity level, with 14 crores of farmers who are engaged, who own land in India, they are engaged in cultivation of different crops. We need to ensure that they get the right price. We are subsidizing the input cost. We are also assuring them the market. But the fact is that if your supply is surplus and demand is less, they will never be able to get the incentive to remain motivated to produce more in agriculture. And that's a phenomena which applies to all other sector also. Whether you are in service or anywhere, if your incentive to get motivated has to be there, otherwise it becomes very difficult. And when there is a surplus production for all the commodities, it is very difficult to ensure that the farmers get the right price. So in order to create a better market for them, if PDS is allowed to sell only the processed food, then the micro food enterprises gets an opportunity to process it locally, supply it through PDS system, and so processing industry gets a boost, and farmers gets a better price because the consumption of the whatever they are producing is processed and value added and then reached to the consumer. So there is a lot of, PDS has got a lot of leakages, which is not the subject for the day. So therefore, I'm not touching upon that. But by supplying the processed food, you can close those leakages and ensure that like a lot of wheat purchased at 2 rupees a kg and then added to the current produce and sold again to the at the minimum support price, which is 17, 18 rupees a kg. So you buy at 2 rupees a kg, sell it for 18 rupees a kg. So your wheat productivity level increases, whereas actually it is not. So those kind of phenomena are happening that can be arrested by this thought process. So these are some of my thoughts. I had received some 2-3 questions.
Those are 4-5 questions that we have received from our participants, actually. Yes. I think the first one is, how can the farmers be supported in this crucial time? Maybe there, one of the points is something that you have already given a lot of insights. Thank you for that. Yes. A lot of great points that can be actually taken aback and, kind of worked upon. However, in this time of not only COVID, however, if you go through the news right now, one of the hottest news is in the last 27 years, India has gotten the worst hit by, locusts.
Yes.
We traveled from Pakistan, went over to Rajasthan, and then towards Punjab. And there are 6 states which are actually taken a real-time bad hit, where a few lakh metric tons of, produce is wasted. How, during this time, can the farmers be supported, and what can be those 2-3 things for the people in the east or in the west? Western part is already under the hit to some extent. Northern part of India is again under the hit. How about, you know, working it out to combat this towards moving towards the south or the east?
Right. Yeah, quickly on to this, my thought process around this question is that, you know, one is that I would say that Pakistan is very unfortunate that, you know, even if something happens, it goes wrong with it. Even if the locust is moving, it is coming from Pakistan only. So people say that it's another form of terror which Pakistan is creating. But my understanding of this movement is that this is a movement which has been there every year. But yes, intensity of, you know, intensity this time is very high. And largely because if you see January, February, March, these 3 months this year, the rainfall has been one of the best. Because these off-season rains, January, February, March, has been highest. And as a result, there has been a lot of greenery which used to be missing. And because of that, locust attack this year is very, very intensified. And just to extend it further, that because of this, even you will see that in spite of COVID, corona impact, there are many social dynamics which are happening, which actually is going to the advantage of agriculture sector. One is that a lot of labor is available in the in the villages these days because of the migrants coming back because of the fear of corona and all that. Second is that along with them, a lot of skill set is returning to villages. And third is that government has already announced a lot of support in the form of Jan Dhan account, then Prime Minister's, you know, Krishi Samman Nidhi, and so, and of course, other subsidies on fertilizer seed is continuing. So I would say that labor is available, skill is available, money is available, and overall, the rainfall is predicted to be normal, whereas January, February, good residual moisture is available. So this year, 2021, according to me, should be one of the best agriculture year in decades to come. That's my take. And so therefore, of course, locust attack is there. I don't have any answer to that. And I can't suggest any preventive action for that. Whatever actions are there, people are already adopting it. But the point I'm taking is that, you know, this year is going to be one of the best year. This kind of locust attack will pass through. There is a damage, but this damage is largely because the advantage we had with more rainfall, which was there, and because of more greenery, this attack has happened.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, sir. So there's one more question which we see. Somebody has asked, actually, any light on agri-allied animal husbandry, breeding and tech sector, or dairy or poultry? So yes. What is your opinion on the change that the entire agriculture and allied, when I say allied, I'm considering animal husbandry, any kind of integration?
Or, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I don't have a ready-made, I'm not an expert in this field, allied area. And but what I can see is that some of the announcement which has been made in the 20 lakh crore package, there is announcement for all these allied area as well, which I have not covered because there is largely the fund allocation from the central government, which will be given to the state based on the proposals they submit. Okay. So it is the state and center, they have to work out, but enough money is available for providing support in these sectors, in these areas, allied areas.
So sir, there is a recent question that we received just now during our discussion. It's, you know, and he's asking about government of Orissa announced today sale through e-market. How will that change the scenario for farmers? Is it possible to
thrive? Interesting. E-markets, actually, see, the problem is that these are modern things and very good things. And I would say that today I'm working with Indorama Kokand Fertilizer, which is a multinational company, which has acquired a fertilizer plant in Uzbekistan. So I came on a leave of 10 days and then I wanted to go back. That's when the lockdown was announced and I got stuck. Now it has been more than 2 months and I'm in the lockdown. Now this has taught me many things. One is that, you know, all along, every day morning, when you are not happy with your wife, you can always go to the office and come back in the evening to settle the scores. But here you can't escape because you have to be there, whether you are happy or unhappy, you have to be in the house. So I am learning the art of how to manage these anger and, you know, interpersonal skills. Second thing is that a lot of work which we believe that it will happen only when you are in the office, when you are having a physical meetings. But now we are coming to realize that actually we can manage it better even when we are not there. So last 2 months, my sales and marketing operations in Uzbekistan probably is one of the best when I'm not there. So this is a new order and every day video call and this thing and lot of decisions, crucial decisions we are taking. So we are learning how to manage under these difficult period and probably this will become permanent because even the management is also finding it very cost effective that, you know, we will be forced to look for a house which should have at least 3 rooms, one for the office and 2 for living. So that's a behavioral change which we are going to foresee, and also, you know, somebody to manage the children so that, you know, they don't interfere when the crucial meetings are going on. So these are the kind of new dynamics which are happening, and they will have a long-term behavioral changes in the in all of us. So I think this is going to also impact in a big way. So the point which you made that how it is electronic markets are going to be beneficial to the farmers. Electronic markets earlier, because of APMC, actually there has been a lot of hurdles which has been removed. So if the farmer is finding it to move from Orissa to, let's say, nearby state and market there and get a better price, he can also use electronic platform to do the same. And physical deliveries can happen simultaneously. So e-markets. Now the only challenge in e-markets is that, you know, like when in 2006-07, when computerization of reservation in railway was introduced, so all the confirmed tickets went to the educated class and uneducated got the waitlisted. So when you introduce these kind of reforms without proper preparedness of the people who are going to use the electronic platform, then this is what will happen. So electronic platform at this stage, I would keep my fingers crossed that how beneficial it would be. It will benefit to some farmer, but not large number of farmers because, you know, the connectivity issue is still in rural area is an issue. And second is that the know-how, the skill set with the farmers, if he goes to somebody else and seeks help, then another commission agent will crop up. So those kind of challenges are there. So I would say that it's a good thought, but probably the customers are not ready today to, users are not ready today to use the e-platform effectively and efficiently.
Right. Thank you so much for your, you know, kind of thoughts and information. So we have a lot of questions popping up, in fact. So problems in e-norm implementation in the States. So that was one of the questions that we received from one of our participants. And then there are more questions that are cropping up. So we have around 8 minutes to go, but I think we can stretch up to another 5 to 7 minutes with your permission.
Right. Yeah. I'm available. That's not a problem. I think most of these questions related to markets. The reforms which I have talked about in Essential Commodity Act and APMC, also getting another law, which is central law, which Government of India has announced. These two things are going to answer most of the questions which are being raised, whether it is e-markets or it is any other form. But I think it is important for you because it's news to me also, because I spent almost 4 decades here, then went to Uzbekistan. And I've been there for a month so far before I came back. interesting thing that you know Uzbekistan cultivates about 44 lakh hectares of land, and they cultivate two major crops, cotton and wheat. And cotton they produce about 3 tons per hectare, and wheat they produce, average productivity I'm talking about, is 4.5 tons per hectare. Now if you compare to India, India produces about 2.8 tons of wheat production per hectare, and cotton is about 0.7 tons per hectare. So 0.7 versus 3 tons, and for 2.8 versus 4.5 tons. That's the productivity difference. Now, Uzbekistan, the interesting thing which I was impressed with, and it's a real good learning for me, that all the agriculture land belongs to government of Uzbekistan. Nobody in Uzbekistan owns the land. So there is a empowered authority at the district level who is fully empowered to allot the land. And this is called a state order, that is government order. So government order is issued that for the year, let's say, to 2020-21, this land will be cultivated by so-and-so, and he will pay the lease rent for it. And state order also says that if you are cultivating wheat, you have to cultivate minimum 60 hectares. If you have to cultivate cotton, then it is minimum 100 hectares. Not have to cultivate, you actually get an order for allotment of land and also the crop. That means the decision to grow the crop is taken by the government, not by the you. And there is a proper performance management system in place for the farmer, that if your productivity level goes down below the target, land would be taken away next year from you and allotted to somebody else. So very interesting.
And these are policies that you're talking about, how the government has intervened and worked it out through and through with the people.
Yes. And you see the benefit of it, that a farmer is really, they are not a farmer. He's an industrialist. He's an entrepreneur. So he does all the, you know, desk work and understands the economics and then applies for allocation of land. And once he gets that, then he goes to the expert and takes the technology. So you will find all the modern technologies, they are in place, they are implemented. Good quality seed, farm machineries, fertilizers, everything. And that's how they are getting good productivity. Here the basis, the key point to understand is, land is a precious resource to ensure food security of the nation. So if you underutilize the precious resource, then it's a crime there. And you will be prosecuted if your productivity levels are not up to the mark. So that is the type of essence with which these policies are implemented there, which I was really surprised to see that. And farmers are very happy. And probably all the questions which you are raising has an answer in this.
Well, that was great, but you know, it is time to contemplate, especially in our setup, like in an Indian setup or setup of, or, you know, the way our state works, Orissa. Will these kind of policies or amendments really work out, or can that be taken up by the private organizations? And you know, probably it will be an experimentation question, and for a lot of entrepreneurs to think through. And it's a think tank question.
Absolutely, I agree with you. It is going to be a challenging here, but the point which I am trying to sensitize is that yes, these kind of reforms or these kind of policies will take long time to come to India. But if we talk about it, if we put our mind to it, probably it will happen faster. But if we don't talk about it and keep depending on the government that, okay, someday government will take these kind of policy decision, things will not happen. So somebody has to accelerate it. So the young entrepreneurs, they can apply their mind, like I talked about these reforms, market reforms, which is throwing up opportunity in warehousing, cold chain, contract farming, FPOs. Now managing an FPO itself is a good opportunity. This requires a lot of managerial skill, so a lot of jobs should be created. Now, if some entrepreneur supplies his mind, obviously when these kind of contracts are happening, then you will find that land leasing is something which needs to be amended. Because leasing of land, like you have two houses in Bhubaneswar, one you can leave, another you can give on rent and sign a proper, say, you know, rent deed. But if you have agricultural land, you can't do that because it is in favor of the one who is stealing the land. So if somebody is stealing for continuously for some certain period, then he is entitled to claim the ownership of the land. So now if you make the amendment in the land laws, which is basically a state subject, somebody has to provide the trigger. Now this trigger, I mean, if it is not coming from young entrepreneurs, who else would be bothered? I mean, others are in comfort zone. So young entrepreneurs have got a major responsibility to take forward. It's not that I'm trying to pass the buck on to young entrepreneurs. I'm just sensitizing because I have learned it only after reaching to the age of 60. So I'm no more young entrepreneur. But it came to my understanding at this age. But yes, we need to, as a youngster, we need to talk about it. That why land leasing should not be legalized. Why should government hold on to it? If we talk on many forum, I am sure at some place it will be heard. And something which may take, let's say, 20 years to come, probably will take 10 years to happen. So yeah. That's the point which I'm making.
So, sir, again, you know, there is no dearth to saying that there are ample and good form of information that you are sharing, which can kind of bring us to a thinking note and doing a lot of new things or taking certain new steps for us as entrepreneurs. So there's someone else who has asked a question. During COVID, the input supply chain for farmers was disrupted. And major is from fertilizer. So here is a question from your area. How fertilizer supply chain will see through the change?
Right.
There is this question on IT intervention. So we did talk about it, but somebody asking on implementation of blockchain or AI, how that will make a difference to the future of agriculture and making it more successful?
Yes. No, I think that's a very good question and very valid one. That during this lockdown, in fact, yes, it's a matter of fact that supply chain was disrupted, and largely those farmers who were sort of growing vegetables and fruits because of the self-life being very short, they suffered a lot and they suffered huge losses. Now, I mean, it's people do make this statement, so I can also make that statement that somebody has to pay the price for the reforms. So these reforms are forced one because of lockdown. This has happened. Somebody has paid the price. There is absolutely, I fully share the pain of those people who have suffered during this period. But at the same time, there is no solution to that also. These are extraordinary moments, and these moments are like war kind of situation. And there can't be a prescription, ready-made prescription to address these kind of situations, because this is once in a while. Coming to the second part of it, that the fertilizer supply chain, I would be very surprised to give this information that, you know, ever since lockdown happened, I think you all understand that today the fertilizers which are subsidized actually is sold through POS, and because there is a subsidy component which needs to be claimed by the companies, and until unless it is sold through POS, subsidy is not available. So the surprising part is that ever since the lockdown was announced, the fertilizer sales jumped up. Now people started looking at, no, no, is there somebody manipulating the sales? The question was that if somebody is manipulating, what is in it for him? So this was verified even by the government, because government was also a little alarmed. The sales of fertilizer in the month of April actually was record high. But then the reason discovered was that because February, March, there was good rainfall and a lot of 36% increase in the sowing area of summer crop has happened. Therefore, fertilizer demand was more and therefore this consumption went up. So that's the true picture. So the point I'm trying to say is that even during the lockdown, government has allowed essential commodities to move freely. And there may be some pockets where this was supply chain was broken and the material was not available. But by and large, it has been quite good. And that's why this year, even 19-20 is going to have record food grain production. And 2021, I am predicting that it will be one of the best agriculture year ever seen in the past 2-3 decades. So I would say that even this lockdown has got a lot of positive side. But yes, those people who have suffered, like the migrants, like some of the farmers growing vegetable growers and all that, those who have suffered, really, I mean, I can only be with them, nothing more than that.
Great. So, sir, as we get ahead with time, you know, there are questions constantly popping up. I also see a
What you can do is you can send me those questions. I will send you an answer on email.
Sure. This is really interesting one. And I entire discussion through, we did talk about how we can have the farmers benefit, the consumer benefits, and overall the industry as well as the country. Here it's a very interesting question where somebody is asking, if we consider the middlemen, how APMC will be benefiting the middlemen?
Yeah.
So this is one of our last
Actually, questions. Whenever you talk about APMC, whenever you talk about APMC, you can't ignore the middleman discussion.
Exactly.
And that actually eats away most of the... I was fortunate that it didn't crop up in between. Otherwise, my own take on this, because there could be a different viewpoint on it. But because I have deeply worked with middlemen, and I was associated with fruits and vegetable procurement and sale, and also partly with the food grains. So, and when you closely work with these middlemen, you understand the value of these middlemen. These middlemen have evolved over a period of, evolved through the social system. So it's not that the middleman is a, villain who has come and, eaten away the major part of the value chain. He is a integral part of the system. The type of services which middleman provides to the farmer, no government entity, no private entity can provide. So he is a valuable man, and therefore he is there in the system on merit. So I'm not trying to idealize middleman, but what I'm trying to say is that those middlemen who did not offer the quality services, did not operate efficiently, they have also gone out of the system. But those who kept adding value to the farmers, they exist on their own merit. And they actually really help the farmer, whether it is giving them the money or supporting the farmer at the various stages. There is a merit in that. So, middleman has a role to play. Sometimes, yes, they take advantage of the situation, which happens in any demand-supply situation where demand is greater than the supply. Suddenly, the behavior of middleman changes. Even a fertilizer seller, when there is a shortage of urea, he will not mind charging 100 rupees, 200 rupees per bag extra. So, that's a behavior, but not all the retailers do that. Fertilizer is core to my heart, so I can guarantee that statement that not all of them do that. But yes, there are many who indulge in these kind of, because nobody wants to lose out on the short-term gains. So middleman is integral part of the value chain. even when you wish them away by, you know, making policy changes, like today you are bringing a new central law which will give an option to the farmer that you can avoid APMC and go. So the middleman seated in APMC, it's not that he will die of hunger. He will find new ways of, you know, mobilizing these farmers to come to APMC. So there will be competition. In the process, the services which was offered by the middleman will improve. And the incentive to the farmer, which he was getting, not getting earlier, will materialize. So I am saying that when the market is going through the competition, it is the consumer and producer, both of them benefit. And value chain becomes efficient. And new learnings, like the point we were talking that today, through the video conference, through the, you know, Zoom, we are able to connect to so many people. Otherwise, you know, I have to travel one day to come to Bhuvaneswar, then spend a night, next day 10 o'clock, come to you, give a lecture for 1 hour, and then, you know, stay for the night. Next day you come back, so you waste 3 days. But today, in 1.5 hours, we have connected to all of you. So this would be an efficient way of delivering things. Acceptance of these kind of changes will come slowly. And we will start, you know, imbibing these behavioral changes over a period of time. So tomorrow, probably, even travel will be less, air travel will cut down, and, you know, many efficiencies will happen. We'll be able to give more time to our family. We'll be able to devote more time to the office than what we were otherwise wasting in travel. So those kind of things will happen. So middlemen's importance should not be misunderstood. It should not be villainized. They have a role to play, and many of them are still playing the role, even in the changed circumstances. Like now, I think it's very interesting example to give. I was actually working with the National Dairy Development Board in my first job. So in 5 years, I have seen that all those middlemen who were earlier involved in trading of the procurement of milk and then supplying to private dairy, after the Amul dairy operation happened, so all those middlemen became secretary of cooperative societies.
Okay.
See, they have the managerial evidence, competence, no? So they became secretary of cooperative societies. So the middlemen will find its way. Tomorrow, when you know, the trading platform changes from APMC to a private market, you will find the same middleman now here as a private trader. He will start dealing separately. So he will find his way. He is having the bandwidth to survive.
Oh, great. So I think we are off time. Sir, I would like to really thank you so much for taking time and sharing really insightful and very, very informative, session with us. Over to you, Glossy. Thank you so much. I would like to thank KTBIN team to have me here on for this session as well, and would like to thank all the participants who were really interactive, and we have so many more questions that actually have popped up, and we have shared an email address to get back, and you know, where we will coordinate with you, and then we can share it back with them, the answers that they need. There are a lot of questions regarding each of them, I think, doing their own bit, and you know, have their own questions, which are limited specific to their business in terms of agriculture.
Sure.
So, sir, great interaction. Thank you one more time. Thanks to everybody. Glossy, over to you, and you can take it out.
Yeah, ma'am, I completely agree with you. Thank you so much, sir and ma'am, for this wonderful session. That was really informative. I also hope that our participants must have enjoyed and they have got the basic idea regarding this topic. And I really thank you all for this sessions, and we'll hope we could join you for another wonderful session so that get a lot of knowledge about various topics related to this day-to-day world.
Sure. I'd be very happy to connect again. Thank you very much and wish you all the best.
Thank you
so
much.
Enjoy the lockdown and be positive. Stay positive.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much.
Same here. Stay safe and be positive. And I'm sure everybody will come through and come out.
Right. Thank you.
Yeah. Bye-bye. Thank you so much. Yeah. Bye-bye. Bye.